Good morning. Welcome, everyone, to the house of the Lord here on this Sunday morning. I'm going to invite you to stand to your feet here today. We want to open up in a time of prayer where we can take all the thoughts from the day, all the stuff of life, all the cares, all the conversations, all the good stuff, and we're going to bring that under captivity to the obedience of Christ. We're going to come in and begin to seek His face here today. You can feel already moving in this place what we would just refer to as a sweet presence of the Lord. You can feel the moving of His Spirit where that comforter wants to step into this house, where the power of the Holy Ghost wants to move in here today. And so the best way I know to do that is to come before His presence by prayer, by supplication, with thanksgiving. And so before we come in to praise and worship, we begin to sing, shout, dance. Can we, with our hands, lift Him to our Lord and our voice and just begin to invite His presence to have His way in this house today, Lord, beyond tradition, beyond, God, just what we know is emotion and what we know is a schedule. God, we want Your presence, Lord, to fill this house today. God, we need Your Spirit to move in like a mighty rushing wind, God, to fill all the house. God, we pray that You would sweep into this house like a mighty rushing wind. Lord, that there would come that wind from heaven will blow across the souls of mankind here again today. Lord, that every broken, wounded spirit would be lifted today by the power of the Holy Ghost. God, that every individual that's come in today looking and seeking and searching would find an answer today, God, by Your presence. Lord, have Your way in this house. We know that You are, and You are a rewarder of them that diligently seek You. Lord, we come in to bless Your name today. And so now, with lifted hands and hearts, we lift up praise and adoration. Lord, it belongs to You. Worthy is the Lamb. Mighty are Your ways, O God, beyond finding out. We worship You in this house. We worship You in this place, O God. Hallelujah to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the answer to every question. Lord, we reverence You. We fear You today. We're in love with You, the mighty King, the mighty God, the everlasting Father. You are today, and You are a rewarder. We love You, Lord. We love You. We're believing in this house today that as we begin to set our mind on Him and we begin to set our affection on Him through the way of prayer and praise, that it's going to do like He said, draw nigh to God and He will draw nigh to you. Let's be intentional about it today, drawing near as the praise team begins to lead us in this time of praise and worship.
Heavenly power, an encore of Pentecost is happening this hour.
Let it fall on me.
Let it fall on me.
Let it fall on me.
A Pentecostal.
Let the Holy Ghost and fire fall on me.
Let it fall on me.
Let it fall on me.
We want it all.
Let it fall on me.
The Holy Ghost.
Breakthrough is coming. Let's raise up a shout.
is my time.
You thought I was worth keeping,
so you cleaned me up inside.
you came and you changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. You thought I was to die for. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, you thought I was to die for. Yes, you thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free. Thank you, Jesus. Why don't we just give him some praise this morning? Come on, why don't we just give him some thanks this morning? That when he died on that cross, he looked at you and me. Thank you, Jesus. And I am forever grateful, Jesus, for you dying on that cross and you shedding your blood for me, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, and we give you the praise and glory, God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. The blessed assurance. We used to sing a song, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. What a foretaste of glory divine. You step in a house like this today and you feel what you're feeling and have the liberty that we have. Let's not so soon forget the freedom, the liberty, and how blessed we truly are today to have what we have and to be able to worship freely and to be able to come back into his presence here today. We're grateful. We're thankful. You may be seated. If our ushers would make their way forward. We want to welcome all of our guests here today. I see a lot of faces out there. I can't wait to meet a lot of people in the house. We welcome you today. There's no telling what God's going to do in your life today as you give the Lord the opportunity by stepping in this house to touch your life and to bless you here today. We, by way of announcement, have a few things as the ushers are making their way forward. How many know what's going on tonight? There you go. Connect groups. Connect groups tonight. There'll be no service here, but connect groups. We're going to be meeting at homes. If you want to be a part of that, you can see almost anybody in the room. They will get you pointed towards the right direction, the right home to get connected with. We would love to have all of our guests connect with us, even in our homes tonight. We'll pray over the offering, then the rest of the announcements. Lord, thank you for the opportunity and the blessing that comes with being a giver today. Lord, we ask that you would bless this offering, bless every giver here today. Lord, because it's written, you said that you would. We pray upon this offering today in Jesus' name. Amen. Coming up this week is Youth Convention. I know we got a lot of excited young people headed down to Youth Convention. Let's keep that in prayer. Let's pray as a church that all the young people would just receive a blessing. This would be a landmark week. That this would be a time of turning for so many and a time of just reconsecrating. Going to be a good week in the Holy Ghost. We're going to keep Youth Convention in prayer. Fire Conference coming up on May 23, 24. That is right around the corner. It's going to creep up on you. And you're going to be like, man, I am so glad I marked that off of my calendar. I know Brother Ken Nelson's going to be here. We're looking forward to Brother Ken Nelson joining us for Fire Conference. He's going to have a great time coming down, being with us. He's a good friend. I'm just giving him a hard time. It's good to see Brother Ken Nelson in the house of God today. Good friend, friend of the family, friend of the church. We're celebrating today with Andrea Bright having been baptized in the only saving name of Jesus Christ. We're celebrating today the goodness of God. Sister Charity Waters working with Sister Andrea, being the disciple maker there. Look what the Lord is doing. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Here we are. You can head back. And not only Andrea, but we also celebrate today with Yoselin. Yoselin was baptized in that only saving name. She's going to make her way up here. Congratulations. We celebrate today in what the Lord is doing. How many how many have went down in that only saving name and now have their life turned around from going one way and now are headed another. Today we rejoice and we celebrate in the goodness of God for how many have been baptized in that name, how many have been filled with His Spirit. And if you're wanting it today, the door is open for you. If you're wanting it, today is that day of salvation. God wants to bring it in your life today. It could be a turning point for your life. The Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. And when you give Him a half of a chance, He's going to take the full opportunity to step into your life and to bring something so magnificent that words would fail to describe it today. God bless you as you give. We're going to continue in praise and worship.
We love You, Jesus. We worship You, Lord. With the name above all names. I am standing here today by Your mercy and Your grace, and with thanksgiving I will say, You're worthy of my praise. You're worthy to as Your glory fills this place. Oh, I will only seek Your face, You alone, and it's with thanksgiving I will say, You're worthy of my praise. You're
Praises God. You deserve my highest praise. We were created to magnify you and glorify your name. God, you put breath in our lungs to be worshipers. You gave us hands. You gave us a body that we could tell the world how great you've been to us. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so today. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. Why don't you greet your neighbor next to you? Introduce yourself if you don't know him. Tell him, I'm so glad to be worshiping the King of Kings with you today. We have many guests here today. Would you put your hands together and make them feel welcome? God bless you for being here. You may be seated. On behalf of everyone who helped out in Sister Leah's funeral yesterday, beginning with Sister Tina Vitale, thank you, thank you, thank you. So many hard workers go to this church, labors of love. They were vacuuming afterwards. Children were in here cleaning up. Some were here, I know, at least till 10:30. They were still here. God only knows how long it was before they got out of here. So if you set up tables, if you helped with whatever it was, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for loving one another, supporting one another, times of sorrow. Because of the funeral, we have several out-of-town guests, and we welcome you from Oregon, from Pennsylvania, from Florida. We welcome you to Humboldt County. It's an honor to have you with us. And so honored to have my mother and father-in-law with us the last week or so. Let's take a vote. Who would like to have a testimony from Sister Pat today?
Praise the Lord. Such an honor, as always, to be with you sweet people. We just count you part of our family, all of you, and I pray for you, and I appreciate your prayers for Brother Wilson and I. And I was reading a scripture this morning, and it just stood out to me so vividly. He said, he will bless his people with strength. He will give his people strength, and he will bless his people with peace. And it just did something to me when I read that, because I know he is a God of peace, and he gives that peace to us as his children. Even in the worst times, I thought of immediately when I read that scripture, I thought of another place in the Word of God in Mark, where the disciples and Jesus were in a storm, and he was asleep in the bottom of the vessel. And when they awoke him, I noticed the wording of that and the punctuation of that. It said he spoke to the winds and the sea, but he said, first of all, he said, peace, comma. I think he wanted the disciples, first of all, to have peace in the middle of the storm. He said, peace, comma. Then he said, be still. He commanded the winds and the waves to cease in the middle of their storm. So even if you're in a storm today, he's speaking peace to you, and he's also going to calm the wind and the waves and give us victory even in our worst times.
My God, we could call an altar call right now. Did you enjoy Brother Wilson's message on Thursday night? Amen. I cannot believe I'm making this next announcement, but that is our dear beloved Sister Rybeck has been promoted to heaven. And so while our hearts are heavy, we rejoice that she has made it to the other side. She has kept the faith and finished her course. Please keep the family in much prayer, and we'll pass along details as they are finalized. Man that is born of woman is a few days and full of trouble. It doesn't matter what you call yourself. It doesn't matter how many titles you have or degrees after your name. If you live in this arena called life, your time passes quickly, and you have to deal with a bunch of stuff. The book of Hebrews chapter 12, just remain seated because we got scripture for days today. See that you refuse not him that speaketh, Hebrews 12 and 25. For if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven. Watch now. Verse 26, whose voice then shook the earth. But now he's promised, saying, yet once more, I'm going to shake the earth only, not the earth only, but also the heavens. And this word, this word about the shaking is going to signify the removing of those things that are shaken. As of the things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. A shaking is taking place in our world to identify those who have their foot upon the rock. He said one more time, I'm going to shake everything to reveal those kinds of people who refuse to be shaken. One more time, I'm going to shake the world of those people that can't be shaken loose from a faith in Christ Jesus. Is there anybody with your foot on the rock and your mind made up? Is there anybody that has a death grip on the nail-scarred hand today? Verse 28, wherefore we receive a kingdom that cannot be shaken. There is a kingdom that will stand. There is a kingdom that's been established by God. Let the winds blow. Let the rains come, let the storms happen, but there is a kingdom that's going to still be standing from the beginning of time. The adversary is trying to take down God's kingdom. We've talked about it the last month in the heavenlies, but there's still a glorious kingdom in the heavens. For centuries, the skeptic's pen has written against the kingdom of God, but they faded off the scene, and the kingdom still stands. Quick-witted, silver-tongued orators have talked about the deficiencies of the kingdom of God, and their bones lie rotten 6 feet under the earth, but the kingdom still stands. In the natural world and in the spiritual world, you cannot touch what God has established. It's still standing today. It'll be standing tomorrow, and in eternity's tomorrow, the kingdom of God is forever settled. So the writer of Hebrews is quoting from the book of Haggai, chapter 2, verse 6. Haggai lists a more extensive list. Not only does he say heaven and earth, let's read it, I'll show you. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, yet once more in a little while I'll shake heaven and earth, the sea, the dry land, and I will shake all nations. That's taking place right now. God only knows what the Middle East situation is going to become. Obviously, Israel is God's time clock. And anytime missiles are coming in, even missiles according to that sacred 36 acres of where the dome is and where the temple's going to be rebuilt and all the things of prophetic outcome with that. Ladies and gentlemen, the nations of the world, where can you go in this world? You name me a place that's safe and secure. You name me a place that doesn't have crime riddled. It's not safe in the streets. It's not safe in your house. You show me a place that's not suffering from pestilence and from outbreaks. Where are you going to run? You thought COVID was a big deal. Just wait till you begin the book of Revelation and the seals are opened up and the plagues are released in the earth and a third of the world's population is consumed in a moment of time. There is no place to run except to Jesus. Hey, friend, you can do life with God or without life, without God, but you got to live in this world. There's going to be hard days in the church or out of the church. I choose to get in something that never changes, that cannot be shaken loose. So God's kingdom cannot be shaken. The shaking reveals what kingdom you're connected to. 1 John 2:18. Little children, it's the last time. You've heard that Antichrist will come. Even now there are many Antichrists, whereby we know that it's the last time. They went out from us, verse 19, but they were not of us, for if they had been of us, they no doubt would have continued with us, but they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not of us. They were shaken loose. 2 Thessalonians 2:2 says, don't be shaken in your mind, because that's where the enemy always comes. Don't be soon shaken in your mind. You get both feet a death grip in the kingdom of God, and you say, God, for God I live, and for God I will die. Because everything, hear me, everything in this world is rumbling. Every institution is rumbling. Every government of this world, as I preach today, is rumbling. The world that you used to know is no more. There is a shaking taking place in every financial system, in every governmental system, in the healthcare system. Every institution of this world is shaking. But there's one thing that does not shake, and that is the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's an unshakable kingdom. You've got to get in God's kingdom today. Amen. Everyone has faith in something. The question is where you choose to place your faith. What is the object of your faith? Jesus said, blessed are those that have not seen and yet believe. Blessed are those that choose to place their faith in the Word of God. Everybody has faith. God's given it to you. The question is, what kingdom have you placed your faith in? Oh, you're gonna put it in your good health? Really? We buried somebody 40 yesterday, and a couple days ago, someone 65 passed from this world. You're not going to put your faith in your company. You really think your government has your best interests? What can you trust in this world but God, who so loved the world, the creator of the world and the redeemer of the world? Come with me to Isaiah 24. You say, well, I just don't think you're preaching to me, okay? Isaiah 24:1. Behold, the Lord maketh the earth empty. The Lord maketh it waste, turneth it upside down, scattereth abroad, and the inhabitants thereof. Look at verse 2. This is amazing. And it shall be as with the people, so with the priest. He said, everybody's going to be shaken. He said, with the servant and the master. He said, with the maid and the mistress, with the buyer and the seller, the lender, the borrower, the taker of usury, the giver of usury. Next verse. The land shall utterly be emptied and utterly spoiled. Verse 5. The earth also defiled under the inhabitants thereof, because, watch now, they have transgressed the law. They have changed the ordinance. They have broken down the everlasting covenant. Don't you ever remember a nation that forgets God shall be turned into hell. The only reason America is a great nation is because it was built upon the principles of God's word. Don't you ever forget, it's not how smart they are. It's not how great they are in their vision. They may send a rocket to Mars, but ladies and gentlemen, that doesn't prove anything. What proves something is if you have the blessing of God. You cannot live one moment without the blessing of God. And your nation has turned their back on the Lord. They've turned their back on the hand of blessing. That's why there's a shaking. The Bible says the whole creation groaneth and travaileth, waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. Matthew 24 and 29 says it this way. Let's go back to Isaiah 24. Isaiah 24 and 19. Stay with me up there, media people. The earth is utterly broken down. The earth is clean dissolved. The earth is moved exceedingly. The earth shall reel to and fro like a drunkard, and shall be removed like a cottage. The transgression thereof shall be heavy upon it. It shall fall and not rise again. It shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall punish the host on high, the ones that are high, and the kings of the earth. I'm telling you what's coming to this world. You better jump in the church. You don't need to dwell in the shallow end of the pool. You need to say, this day I'm giving it all I've got to serve the Lord. I'm not going to live on the fence. Put me in the kingdom of God. How are you going to make it through life? Bible tells a story in the book of Judges that there was one by the name of Phinehas that inquired of the Lord. They said, should we go out to battle tomorrow? And the Lord spoke and said, go out to battle and I'll give you victory. But 1 Samuel chapter 28 inquired of the Lord, verse 6. And when Saul inquired of the Lord answered him not, neither by dreams nor Urim or Thummim or by the prophets. Because if you read down a few verses, he disobeyed the law of God. He cried out to the heavens, but the heavens were silent. Because he transgressed the law of God. Hear me today. This is a day to fall in love with God's word all over again. This is a day to repent and return to your first works. I'm preaching to a people today, not this church. I'm preaching to the spirit age today. They think they're rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. And we've never needed a savior more than we need him today. I preach to the spirits of the ages. I need God. You need God. We are in desperate need of a savior. And we need to fall in repentance across the nation and say, Lord, save us from what is to come. Save us from ourselves. Amen. Remember a few years ago, we were fishing down, bottom fishing at the Cape Mendocino. If you look at a map, it's the little bump on a map. It's the most western point in the United States. It's a great day of fishing. But because of the location being the most extreme western point of the United States, the weather can change so quickly, and on this day it did. We had a box full of fish. I made the cardinal mistake that you only make one time in your life. Fishermen only make it once. A lot of times they don't live to tell the stories why it's only made one time. That is, because we were fishing and catching so much fish, we had the music going, we had the radio going, the walkie-talkie deals. We had the fish finder going, we had the Loran going, we had the GPS going, and it drained the battery. And we're just laughing, and out of nowhere, when I tell you this, you have to believe me, the wind can just start blowing down there. It's like no other place in the United States. It can be completely calm and then completely blowing. And all at once, we're drifting quickly into these rocks. So I jump to the steering wheel and I turn the ignition and it just goes click, click. The wind's blowing. What do? Somebody says, put the anchor out, put the anchor out. We go to the anchor and, you know, of course it's wrapped up. And of course there's a knot and you can't get it. We're fiddling with the anchor and some of the guys are grabbing that. Finally, we get it down and just before we would crash on the rocks and the anchor grabbed us. But now all at once, blue sky is giving away. It's just a storm. You can't see from here to that wall. The clouds have come in, and it's just thick clouds. And what do? We're stuck down here. The engine doesn't work. If we pull the anchor, if the anchor slips, we're going to be in the rocks just a matter of a few seconds. So we did have enough juice not to turn the engine over, but the walkie-talkie, the radio still worked. VHS, we got on it. We said, we're stuck down here, and we're right next to the rock. Of course, you can't fish there now. It's off limits. And so I cannot tell you how happy we were when there was a boat that just emerged right in front of us. And they just happened to have a battery pack with them. And they said, sure, we'll help you. And hooked it up, started it. And, oh, we were just so relieved. And the reason why they found us, though, is we were fishing right near another rock formation. It's the Cape Rock of Mendocino. And they knew, according to their GPS, they hadn't turned off their engine. They knew where that rock was. And they knew how to navigate to get there. I want to preach to us today. You better not be blindly going through life without some sort of spiritual mechanism to help you navigate the shakening that's taking place in this world. You say, well, I've lived 20, 40, 70, or 80 years. I've done okay. You haven't lived in the world you're fixing to live in. Hear me, hear me, hear me, hear me. There is no baseline for that. The areas that we're going to navigate, the coming of the Lord, this is a brand new arena of life, and you better have a spiritual connection to God. You better have someone that's author and finisher directing your vessel, or you will be shipwrecked in life. Nautical navigation has come a long ways. When they first started, I'm told that they would just stay close enough to the shore and they would venture out. That depended on how much visibility was that day, how far out they would go. And so they just stayed close. And then they ventured out a little more. If you read and research it, they would follow the seabirds. If the bird had a fish in its mouth, it was heading back towards shore to eat. If the bird had no fish in its mouth, it was probably heading out towards the fishing or hunting grounds for the bird. And so at least they had a sense of which way land was. Of course, they navigated by the sun at 12 noon. They would certainly know according to the shadows. And then at nighttime, they would navigate by the stars. Of course, the North Star was so important there. And the constellations, of course, you have to know what season it is, because different constellations are visible at different seasons of the years. And then they begin to figure out some more stuff in the Mediterranean Sea, the warm south wind and the cold north wind. And they would be able to get their bearings, of which eventually the eight principal winds were named. And so they did pretty good. But even with this, what do you do if you can't see the stars or you can't see the sun, what do you do? How do you account? They took meticulous records, but how do you account for the wind blowing? How do you account for a tide change? How do you account for the currents that are out there? And there has to be something better. Many people lost their lives. Many people made shipwreck. The global positioning system, the GPS, finally came along in 1973, and it was a game changer, because it helped so many people. 31 satellites are above us today. They tell us that there are 4 satellites at all times that are open. 4 satellites that you can connect with. I know, and those hunters in the room here today that's been in some steep terrain, oftentimes you're in the bottom of a canyon, you turn on your GPS, find your way back to camp, and it just spins, and it gives this heading at the top. It says acquiring signal. That means that there's an obstruction where the sides of the mountains are so steep it can't connect with the satellites in the sky, and some people try to live their life without ever connecting to the satellites that give direction. We've read the funny stories of people that did not have a lock on their satellites. They were still acquiring, but they took off anyway. We could go and find the man that was stuck on the stairways of the Riverside Park in New York, or the man that drove his car following his GPS into the bay in Australia, or to a drop-off cliff. Teeter-totter in his car, he slipped out before it fell over the cliff. They drove into a lake, into a house, into a cherry tree in which they had to cut down to get the car loose, and stuck into a sand pit, all because they received false data from their GPS. What's your GPS reading today? I know your GPS is talking, but is your GPS connected to the right source? I know there's chippering going on, talking in your head, but my question is it giving you accurate directions to make it through the shakening that is coming to this world? They tell me pilots, when they start learning to fly an aircraft, they have something called chasing the needle. And they're trying to get their plane leveled off at the right plane in the degrees. And there's always overcompensation when it takes place. I've seen people driving a boat, and usually people say, oh, my electronics, they just quit on me. That's usually not the case. It's usually they're not following their electronics. They're overcome or distracted with the moment. Even on a compass, you can turn that boat in circles trying to find the right heading because you're overcompensating. Usually when there is an airplane accident, it's because of pilot error. There's some connection between them and their electronics. If they ever get their electronics right, it will lead them safely home each time. If we were to go to Alamo today and rent a car, sometimes they try to upsell you a GPS. Of course, everybody has them in their phones now, but a few years ago, and that upgrade advertisement would say, get your directions from the satellites, not just the gas station. Because if you're not getting it from a good, reliable source, you can get twisted around sometimes. You see, when you're connected to a source that is above this world, when you're connected to a source that is not interfered with the stuff down here, when you're connected to a source that is above, you see things that other people do not see. You're not bothered by other things. The chatter doesn't affect you because your confidence is being connected to a God that is eternal. You see, on the day of Pentecost, Peter stood up while a bunch of people were talking in tongues, receiving the Holy Ghost. And he recognized something that the rest of the 3,000 people did not recognize. And however many people was in the crowd that day, he said, "This is that which was spoken of by the prophet Joel." He had an understanding that was beyond what everyone else saw. And I preach to us today that we've got to have an understanding above what Fox News tells you. You've got to have an understanding beyond what Grandma Susie tells you. You've got to have a connection with the satellites that are out of this world. I'm talking about heaven's satellites today. I'm talking about the King of Glory will guide your steps. The King of Glory will come down and help you understand. You see, Jesus was just a little baby, 40 years of age, brought to the temple, and Anna and Simeon said, "Hey, there is the Messiah. There's the consolation of Israel." Everyone else just saw a little ruddy-faced baby. But Anna and Simeon said, "No, this is the Savior of the world. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." God's calling the church, saying it's just about homecoming time. It's just about rapture time. We can't go through the motions. We can't just have church and routine and church and routine. The coming of the Lord draweth nigh. We've got to hasten to it. Everything in life's got to focus towards it. It's midnight hour. The bridegroom is coming. Yeah. Bible tells us that a prodigal was in a hog pen. And the Bible tells us that he came to himself in a hog pen, eating unclean food, unclean animals, but he came to himself. How much more does the hired servants in my father's house have? They have bread in excess. I will arise and go back to my father's house. Watch now. He gets out of the hog pen and he starts down the road towards his father. His father is there waiting and looking for him. The point I'm making today is, even though he was a prodigal, we don't know why he left. All we know is he ended up where he ended up. The details are irrelevant. All that matters is that when he wanted to come back to the Father's house, he knew how to get back. If you're a prodigal here today, the details are irrelevant. We don't care where you went shipwrecked. We don't care where you went awry. But we're simply saying, come back to the Father's house. And if you take one step, God will direct you the whole way. The story is told of an old Scottish woman who went from home to home across the countryside. She was selling threads and buttons and shoestrings. She didn't have a sophisticated GPS. She carried a stick in her pocket. When she would come to a crossroads, she'd take that stick and spin it in the air. Whichever way it fell, that's the road she would take. They observed her one day, taking the stick and throwing it in the air. Fell on the ground. She picked it up, threw it in the air again, did it again. They inquired, "Why are you throwing the stick in the air?" She said, "Well, when I come to road, I just throw it in the air whichever way it lands on, but it keeps saying go to the road on the left, and I want to go to the road on the right." Watch now. You can get whatever instruction you want to get. Get on the internet, Google it up. You can find anything to support any theory. As crazy, as wacko as you want to go, there's somebody going to, some expert that's done research is going to tell you that's the right way. You can pick up your stick and just keep throwing it, find anything you want. Or you can come back, get in the book, plant your feet and say, "God, I'm here and I'm following you." While everything else is shaking, the house stood firm. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not into thine own understanding. All thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. Group of scientists were studying humanity. They're from the Max Planck Institute, biological cybernetics in Germany. They took 10 people out. They wanted to give an experiment of something that they had seen, observed over and over and over. They put a GPS system on them. They told them to walk in a straight line. Those that were let off in the Sahara Desert, they didn't walk in a complete straight line, but they did pretty good. They veered slightly, and they followed the moon. But when the moon went down, I got to find this in my notes here. Suddenly, they turned 90 degrees within just a few minutes. As long as they had the sun guiding them and the moon guiding them, they did pretty good on a flat, open desert. But as soon as that went down, within a couple minutes, they turned 90 degrees twice because they lost all sense of direction. They took 4 of the 10 and put them into a densely forest area of Germany. And they said, we want you to walk in a straight line. And repeatedly, they went in circles, sometimes every 10 minutes. Folks, you can't do it by yourself. They took video footage of these people that walked in circles when they thought they were walking in a straight line. And I quote, they didn't really believe when we showed them afterwards. I think that's certainly the point to take away. People may feel very confident about the direction they're going, but it's not certain. They would have told you, no, I'm walking in a straight line. But when you went back and looked at the videotape, they were doing this. I'm showing you a picture of our world today. They think they're doing what's right, but they can't walk the straight line to the eternal gates. They're simply walking in circles. It's impossible. Nobody is self-made. Nobody's smart enough. You've got to be connected to a source that is greater than this world, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. It's called spatial D, or spatial disorientation. It's the inability to determine one's position and location relative to their environment. They call it the phenomenon of unawareness. Clouds, fogs, haze, whiteout, storms. The possibility, hear me now, of becoming spatially disoriented is hardwired into all humans. 1954, they did a study at the University of Illinois Institute of Aviation and found out that 19 of 20 non-instrumented rated pilots went into the proverbial graveyard spiral soon after entering a condition that would have produced, it was clouds or fogs where they could not see visually the ground or the horizon. And 19 out of 20, within 178 seconds, all went into the proverbial downward spiral of the aircraft. And the 20th pilot lost control of his aircraft. It was just in a different maneuver. Because it's impossible to make it out by yourself. You have got to have the Word of God. You've got to have a man of God. You've got to have a church body. You've got to have fitly joined together and compacted every joint supplieth. But I'm here to tell you the other side, once we've convinced you can't make it by yourself, there's not a devil in hell. There's not a difficult situation. There's not anything that can come to detour you away from where God has has destined for you to go. When you're connected to God, He's going to ensure that you make it all the way. January 26, 2020, the world was shocked. It was a veteran pilot. He got on the radio, said, "I'm climbing to 4,000 feet. 12 seconds later, he would have got there. But he got confused of where he was. High speed left turn descent, 180 miles an hour, descending 4,000 feet per minute. And all the while, he thought he was heading in the right direction up. He was going in the opposite direction down. And they contacted the ground at full speed. You know about it because Kobe Bryant, his daughter, was on that aircraft that day. So he was a veteran pilot. He thought he knew how to do it. I'm preaching today that nobody knows how to do it by yourself. You've got to have a source greater than you, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. That is He who is able. He's Alpha and Omega. He lives in yesterday, and He lives in tomorrow, and He will see us through. Can I preach a little longer today? God cannot fail. God cannot lie. And God cannot change. Look at Psalm 68 and 19. I want to preach for the next few moments, not about a global positioning system, but I want to preach about God's GPS system. God's promise system. Psalm 68 and 19. Blessed be the Lord, who daily loadeth us with benefits, even the God our salvation, Selah. Stop and think about it. Who daily, every day, He loads us with blessings or benefits. That means on my bad days, I'm still got a life cram-packed full of the blessings of God. On the days I feel depressed, I still have a life that's jam-crammed-packed with the blessings of God. When there's tears in your eye and your back is bent over, it's still a day that God loads us with blessings. You need to lift your eyes a little higher today. Instead of cursing the crisis, we need to thank God that daily He loads us with blessings. Come with Matthew 28 and verse 20. Matthew 28 and 20. I don't get to preach tonight to you, so you get two sermons for the price of one. Matthew 28 and 20. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the world. You know what God's GPS says? You know what God's promise system says? You will never be alone. When it feels like nobody cares, God said, I'm there with you. When it seems like no man stood with you, Brother Steve, God says, I'll stand with you. When it seems like there's not friend or family or church member, and you look at the phone and you say, God, please let somebody call me to give me a word of encouragement today. You've got to understand God's promise system. He said, I'm with you. When there's tears in your eye, God's with you. When it's heavy in life, God's with you. When you're climbing the mountain all alone, God is with you. Come with me to Deuteronomy 31 and 6. Be strong and of good courage. Fear not, nor be afraid, for the Lord thy God, He it is that doth go with thee. He will not fail thee. He will not forsake thee. I feel like reading it again. Be strong and of good courage. Fear not. Stand to your feet. Let's read this together. Ready, begin. Be strong and of good courage. For the Lord thy God, somebody raise your hands and receive the word of the Lord. That's God's GPS for us today. Plug into it. Acquire that signal from heaven. You may be seated. Joshua 1 and 5. There shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I'll be with thee. I will not fail thee. I will not forsake thee. 1 Chronicles 28 and 20. Come on, somebody preach with me. And David said to Solomon his son, be strong and be of good courage. Do it and fear not, nor be dismayed. Why? For the Lord thy God, even my God, will be there with thee. Will be there with thee. Will be there with thee. He will not fail thee nor forsake thee until thou hast finished all the work of the service of the house of God. Come on, he promised his presence. He promised his presence. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you're not alone. I'll fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thou art every step, every valley, every mountain, every crossroad, every vehicle, every turn, every curve. Even when you can't see him, he's watching. Even when you can't detect him, he's guiding, he's protecting, he's leading, he's watching over you. Even when it seems like nobody cares, the Bible even says, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days. Every good and perfect gift comes from him. That just means no matter where you go, God is there in his presence. You just don't know. You don't know my situation. Well, you don't know what Psalms 139 and 7 says. Whither shall I go from your spirit? Where could I get away from your presence? If I go to the heavens, thou art there. And if I make a bunch of bad decisions and I end up in hell, behold, thou, I'm here to tell you, God will chase you to hell and back. Somebody say, God's with me. First King said, oh, he's just a God on the mountains. Bring him down in the valley, we'll eat your lunch. You can just do that church stuff in church, but you get out in real life. Oh, yeah? He said, I'll show you he's not just a God of the mountain. He's a God of the valley. They had chariots with big swords on their wheels. They would mow people down. But when God's there, nothing stands against it. I'm here to tell you, God's going to go with you. I curse the lie of the enemy that says you don't count, nobody cares about you. God said, until the end of the world, I will go with you. You know what that means? When his presence is there, in his presence there's fullness of joy. And at his right hand, pleasures forevermore. I know your back is hurting today, but you are surrounded by the goodness of God because in his presence it is there. I'll give you one more scripture, Psalms 41 and 12. And as for me, thou upholdest me and mine integrity. And notice this last part of the verse. and thou settest me before thy face forever. You can't see it, but God said, I'll put you right before my face. You move over here, God said, you're right before my face. God, where you at? He said, I'm looking at you. Oh, come on. Don't you remember the story in the Bible when Jesus is on the mountain praying and the disciples were rowing their boat? They got in the middle of the lake and they just couldn't figure it out. They were saying, God, where you at? Why are you letting the storm come? And God was watching them the whole time. God sees where you're at. So not only God's presence goes with you, but God's promise system, he's promised strength to you. I just don't know if I can take it. Don't ever say that again. Because God keeps his word, and his word keeps you. Come with me to the book of Isaiah, chapter number 40 and verse 29. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increaseth their strength. The youth shall faint, be weary, the young man shall utterly fall, but not you. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. It's going to be like an eagle that mounts up and sets his wings. You're going to run and not be weary. You're going to walk and not faint, because God has promised you strength. Now let me quote to you Psalms 29 and 11. Thank you, Sister Pat, for being in the Holy Ghost. If you didn't get it from Sister Pat, the Lord's giving you a mulligan, a redo. The Lord, this is scripture she just quoted in her testimony. She didn't know it's right there in my notes if you want to zoom in. Psalms 29 and 11. The Lord will give you strength. Come on, he's going to make your feet like hinds feet. I know you're tired and weary and moping around. I know you've been in a faith fight. I know you're battle worn, but God's going to sweep in this house and give you supernatural strength. The Lord will give you strength, and he's going to give his people peace. If you're ready to receive it, just raise your hands to heaven right now. Father, open the portals of heaven and give your people peace and strength in the name of Jesus. Somebody finish quoting this scripture. And as thy days are, so shall thy strength be. As thy days are, so shall thy strength be. Dad's going to be 80 in September, and he's given him strength for every single day. I hope it's in the providence of God for him to live to 100. Whatever it is, there is a guarantee you'll not live one day beyond God's strength. He said, as long as your heart's beating, I promise you strength for that day. Strength to look the adversary in the eye and say, devil, you tried, but I'm still standing. Strength to say, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. You're going to make it on God's strength. Psalms 41 and 10. For thou, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. God said, I'll strengthen you. God said, I'll help thee. God said, I will uphold thee. Do you think God's surprised by your circumstance? You think God's looking for a contingent plan and figure it all out? He saw it before you ever got here, and he said, I'm going to give you the strength to walk through it, climb every mountain, and be victorious. I read one time a scripture in the Bible, and it said, all things work together for the good to them who love God. This promise is not for unbelievers. This is a promise for believers. And we know that all things work together for the good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. And the enemy will lie to you and tell you only the good things, the blessings, are meant for your good. But the Bible says all things work together for the good. All things are working for your good. You're cursing it. God said, I'm trying to work something good in you. You're praying it away. God say, why are you praying away a blessing? Can I preach to you about one more GPS? God's promise system, he promised provision. Genesis 22, let's go with Abraham on the top of the mountain. He climbs up the mountain. While he's climbing up, ram's climbing up the other side. He builds an altar, lays his son there, takes a knife, opens a knife up, Genesis 22 and 13. Says, the heavens opened and hollered out, Abraham, now I know I can trust you. And then the Lord went on to say this in verse 13. And Abraham lifted up his eyes, and there looked, and behold, behind him, a ram caught in the thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering instead of his son. God supplied. God provided. Verse 14. And Abraham called the name of the place Jehovah Jireh, God who sees and God who provides. Watch now. Watch what he didn't call the mountain. He didn't call it the mountain of a hard place in life. He didn't call it the mountain of a trial. He could have. It's the biggest trial of his life. He didn't say the mountain where I wanted to die. He took all of his attention off of himself and he put it on God. And he said, this is the place where God saw me and he provided for my needs. I've been young and I've been old, but I've never seen the righteous forsaken. I'm here to tell you today that God will provide for you. If you need emotional help, he'll give it to you. If you need financial help, he'll give it to you. Whatever you need, God is still Jehovah Jireh. If you need to catch a fish with a coin in its mouth, God can do that. If you need water streams in the desert, he can do that. God gave a manna every single day from heaven. They complained. He said, I'll send you quail. There was a stack of quail. I don't remember how big it is, but it's a long line, stacked up quail. They ate quail till it came out of their teeth. Because God can supply. I think we just need to clap our hands, recognizing today that God is our supplier. God is our supplier. God is our supplier. He will provide. He will provide. Does anybody want a bonus today? God's GPS, God's promise of protection. Psalms 5:11, you're going to love this. But let all those that put their trust in thee rejoice. Why are we going to rejoice? Let them ever shout for joy. Don't let there be one dead service. Because thou defendest them. There's never a good reason to allow the adversary to shut down your praiser. Not my words. Don't listen to the preacher. Listen to the eternal word today. But let all those that put their trust in thee rejoice. Let them ever shout for joy because, ever shout for joy, because thou defendest them. I'm going to show you one more scripture. Are you ready to be amazed? Exodus 23 and 22. If this, Papa used to say, if this doesn't get you excited, you don't have a switch. Are you ready? Watch this. But if thou shalt indeed obey his voice, everything's contingent on obedience throughout the Bible, and do all that I speak, then I will be an enemy to your enemies. That's what God said. He said, anything that's hurting you, I'm going to hurt. Is that what the book says? He says, I'll be an enemy to your enemies. That's God's promise today. You're not by yourself. There is a God of divine presence even to the end of the world. He'll be with you on your worst day, in a family fight, in a difficult situation at work. God is with you. He said, I'll give you strength. He said, I'll provide. And he said, I will be your protector. I've told the story before. My great-grandfather, my mother's father, was a missionary in Russia. They told him to stop preaching the name of Jesus. And he kept preaching the name of Jesus. They took him to jail, said, don't do it again. They released him and he started preaching the name of Jesus, put him in jail again. They did that for a few times, and they don't play and like they do in the United States. They're serious. They called out a firing squad. Said, do you have any last words to say? And he said, I do. And he raised his hands and he started praying. He said a few words in his native tongue, then he started speaking in a heavenly tongue. He prayed loud. In that heavenly language, when he put down his hands, there was not a gun or a man with a gun that was seen in sight. They said, we thought you didn't understand the Russian dialect. You just spoke perfect Russian. He said, I don't understand the Russian dialect. I don't speak Russian. They said, well, you just said while you were praying that if you don't lay down your guns and leave, the angel of the Lord is going to devour every one of you. Come on. You're not doing this thing by yourself. This is not a Cracker Jack religion. This is not box top religion. When you grab a hold of apostolic power, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Is there anybody hungry for all that God has today? I want you to raise your hands towards heaven and open your heart right now and just say, God, I want to be connected to you. I want to have the real source today. Come on, you don't have to live confused in life. You don't have to live your life on the merry-go-round. Jesus, we need you. We desire you, God. Just lay your hands on your neighbor. I feel the Lord minister knocking. I hear the loud knock of God upon people's door. Would you just pray? I hear the tender voice of a Savior saying, it is I. I know he had to flow through this broken human vessel. But would you open your voice right now to the power of God? He knows you by name right now. Nathaniel, I saw you under the fig tree. I saw you before you ever saw me. That's beautiful. Open that door. Let him come in. Have lunch with you. Sup with you. Nobody deserves it. We're going to all come around the altar in just one more moment. Allow me to make one more plea today. I told you God cannot lie. God cannot fail. God cannot change. There's one more thing God cannot do. Are you ready? God cannot let sinners go to heaven. You know who's going to heaven? Are you ready? Perfect people go to heaven. Well, who's perfect in this room? Certainly not this preacher. I promise you. Nobody. But do you realize when he puts his righteousness in you, you become perfect, sinless? We've got to have him today. It's not optional. We need to quickly come around this altar. It's a family altar. Let's come around and say, God, I don't want to live just acquiring satellites. I want you to lead my life. I need you, God, to be a better fan. Every relationship that I represent, God, I need you to guide me. I need you to guide my thoughts. I need you to guide my values and purposes in life. God, everything is shaking around me. I want something that's steadfast. Keep coming in close. Keep coming in close. They're piling in the altars. God's going to do a sovereign work today. God's going to answer questions today. You're going to feel the embrace of his hand. Everybody praying with somebody. Everybody seeking God. It's supernatural power. It's beyond what the natural man can achieve. It's beyond that realm of human intellect. It's from heaven. Tell him, God, I want to connect with you today. Let him give you strength today. You're heavy with life. Let him be your burden bearer. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Let him give you rest and peace today. Rest and peace today. whosoever will. Come on, choose to put your faith in His Word. God, I need you today. I can't walk without you holding our hand. Ask Him, He'll give you peace today. He'll give you strength today. Trust His promise. With all your heart, trust His promise. Say yes to Him.
You know my name.
He's calling you by name. He's calling you by name. He's got a promise for your life. Let body ministry take place. Pray one for another. Build your life on the Word. Build your life on the Word. Build your life on the Word. If you need to be water baptized, we have hot water, new robes, dry towels. Whatever you need, God is here.